What we will discuss about is about the green economy that you have. I don't know who from you, who is presenting those texts, the document I was, you two?
Yeah.
Okay, good. okay, that I will not talk about now because you will present the issue and we'll discuss all together, you and me, later in the second part of the teaching. At the beginning, there is a topic I really like, which is the commons. I will talk a little bit about the commons, but I know that Coria, Benjamin Coria, has also a seminar with some of you about this issue, and that he's also speaking in this plenary session. I don't know if he did, or if he already did. Meaning that we have not exactly the same approach, Benjamin and me, but I don't want to repeat what he had already said. Okay, that's why I will start by another entrance point. The entrance point is the following one. If you already know all, but I will check it quickly with you, we can try to change and I will invent something else. The issue is why to learn or to study or to work in economy. That's the departure point. I'm sure that during your first degree, when you were preparing your licence in French or your degree, you had a lot of things on history of economical theories or theories of economy or whatever. I'm sure that you all know about Adam Smith, Ricardo, Marx, Polanyi. I hope that his job, that you all know the difference between political economy and economy. All those things are okay for you, I suppose. Yeah?
Not sure.
Not all? Okay, we'll see, but it's not my point. My point is a different one. For you, for example, when economy was starting to be studied as field, what's the beginning? When did you put it in the timeline?
In which country?
In the world. In the world. Be broad. 19th century.
Late
19th. How's that? Before? Which is the 18? With? What are you thinking at?
Physiocrats.
Yeah. Who knows physiocrat? Raise your hand, most of them. It was mainly a French theory. It's the beginning of the economy, where you have to have a balance between export and import, to be very schematic. It's a little bit more complex, but that's a scheme, if you want. Okay. 18, 19. But look at other fields. Before other field, why at this time, 18 or 19? You had a course about that? Enlightenment is better than Industrial Revolution. There is a little relation. Enlightenment, yeah. I think it's like that, whatever. Forget, excuse my spelling. I'm not always good in English spelling. But at the same time, why? The humanity work, we can say it from the Neolithic, meaning 10,000 years ago. And if you look at the knowledge, look at mathematics, medicine, astronomy, philosophy, important fields. You know, when they start to be studied or treated as a sort of specific field of knowledge. Philosophy, often people said in Europe, that is the 5th century before Christ, Pericles, Greece, Platon, Socrates, then Aristotle. That generally in the Western world, but China will be different as well, and China is even before. Okay, look at mathematics. You all know that, for example. Y equal AX plus B. You did that when you were in the secondary school, even at the beginning. You know where that's come from? We need that algebra?
Arabic algebra.
Algebra, that's the Arabic name, you are totally right. Much, much before, Sumer. It's really the beginning of the civilizations and the big city, the state cities, 3,000 years before Christ, 5,000 years ago. Why they did that? It's a problem of heritage. I have three kids. If I die now and I have 3,000 euros in my bank account, it's quite simple. Each kid will take 1,000. But if I have a cow, if I have a horse, if I have something which is difficult to divide, of course you can cut the tree on tree the cow and eat it immediately, but if you don't want to eat it, it's a real problem. That's why you have X. Y is the number of children, and X is the variable. The variable is the cow. And they start to create the algebra, which is something you learned 10 years ago, more or less, because of this specific problem of heritage. But you see that humanity created field of research or knowledge long, long, long ago, at the beginning of the civilization, mainly. Why not economy? Because they were working. They were working even hard and a lot, the slaves in particular, but not only. And that's it, yeah. Yeah, but they have it embedded in one discipline. Look at, for example, philosophy. It's clear that in the Greek tradition, Platon and Aristotle separated, we can say, because they are very different visions, the philosophy from religion. But in most of the country in China, you are, I don't know, the Taoism, the Confucianism, all those things, you have a clear embedment between both. And later, after the Greek, look at all the European philosophers, the first one, they were all religious. And philosophy was totally embedded in religion. Saint Augustine, Augustine, I don't know in English how you said in Spanish, Augustine, but whatever. Those things existed, even if they were embedded in another field. Where could have been embedded the economy? Nowhere. Nowhere. And that was challenging, to imagine why this field, which is seen as so important, was out. No one was talking about. And that, my starting point. You want to say something?
No, it was just that Aristotle also talks about economy, and Buridan, Oreme, like our Copernico.
Really economy?
Well, now, from our days, we can call that economy. It wasn't a separate field.
Yeah.
It was inside philosophy. It wasn't that it was forgotten, and it like appeared out of nothing.
I'm not so sure of that. We can really look at and work on this issue. For me, there is a big emergence of a new field of thinking, of knowledge at this time. And what I want to show you is that it's related to the vision of the world you have. And that before this period, a lot of things made impossible to really talk economy as we are talking about economy today. The main things are a little bit enlightenment, but you will see that there is two other things extremely important. One, which is not the most important, but it is a little bit, is the university. You know, the kind of university you are in, here or in your country or wherever, in your degree, was created, generally you use the name of Humboldt. There are two brothers, careful with Humboldt. One is a geographer. You have the Strait of Humboldt and all those things. And the other one created in Germany, it was Minister of Education, the modern university. What we know, more or less, with some differences, but what we know, it's beginning of the 19th. Just after the Vienna Treaty and the reorganization of Europe after the defeat of Napoleon. But more important than that, and I will write it here, is the victory of liberalism. Liberalism, not in an economical sense, and not neoliberalism and all those things, we are all other things. Liberalism in politics. And that's come from politics, or politics. What the problem? The problem is the fact that in the 19th century, you could say that you have three visions of the politics who were competing and challenging each other. You had a little bit of socialism. Who emerged through Owens in Great Britain, then Marx, Proudhon, and others in France, in Germany, or whatever. But forget a little bit socialism. It's not the most important thing I want to discuss with you. It's the big shock between the reactionaries or conservatism and liberalism. After the French Revolution, the theory of conservatism was totally dominant. The idea was very simple, that societies are like Pandora box. You know all the Pandora box. You know this story coming from Greece. If you open the Pandora box, a lot of disaster jump out and destroy the society. And for the reactionary people, to let the box close it's absolutely essential because the society is too complex to be managed. And what you have to do is to accept the historical and traditional order, meaning the king, the landlord or whatever, and the pater familias, of course, because it's most 99% of the society, men dominated and men oriented. Okay, and the idea is that you cannot touch that, you cannot confront this reality. Because if you open the Pandora box, you finish with the French Revolution or the British Revolution and the Terror or Cromwell in England. And against that, the first one was Hobbes with the Leviathan, but then in France and other countries, using this kind of counterexample of Robespierre and the Terror, you have to let the Pandora box close. That was dominant. The liberalism is a totally different theory. It's the idea that you can manage the society to make it become better. That was not at all what the reactionary tradition and thinking was explaining. At the opposite, it was really let close the Pandora box. The liberalism was, of course, coming from part from the Enlightenment, but the link is not exactly this one. There is no direct link between Enlightenment and liberalism. You can be enlightened if you want and think at a good society. Look at Rousseau, for example. There is no obligation of being liberal when you are in the Enlightenment. Hobbes is seen as one of the first Enlightenment theorists in England, for example. And he was not at all in favor of that. He said that we need a strong king to avoid Cromwell and the history of the first British Revolution. Meaning that liberalism was really winning, in fact, after the big revolution of 1848 in Europe. In England, Disraeli is the most well-known prime minister, was really in this thinking, and then all Europe became influences and by liberalism, and liberalism became dominant. Because Disraeli and the others were able to convince their peers, the other leaders, that if they don't do that, they will get a revolution. And they will be, like in France, expelled by the people. If they want to maintain the power, they have to stop to think that only king and pater familias have to manage the society. You have to accept that you have to do better. And on that, it's true that it's a little bit the Industrial Revolution. Because, of course, the growth of the working class makes dangerous the management of the country, because you have a class who was fighting for their right. And that was the beginning in 1848 of the frightening working class looking in the eyes of the dominant and ruling class. That started in Britain before, with all the Chartism and all those things, 1820, 1830, because the working class was stronger in Britain than somewhere else. But after 48, it was all Europe. And Europe converts itself to liberalism. But convert yourself in liberalism, meaning that you need to have tools to manage the society. You need to have tools to make the society better. And those tools have to be found in the knowledge, and the knowledge comes from the university. That's why the economy and then sociology emerged at the end of the 19th century, really, even if Adam Smith is before, the physiocrats are before, Ricardo is before. But the fact to imagine that this field of knowledge is so important in the uni become very key and absolutely essential when liberalism was winning. Because you need to manage the society. And for that, you need indicators, you need figures, and you need tools. And those tools are given by economy and sociology. They are the only tools you can get. Yeah, tell me what you think.
It's disturbed by what you're saying, but I get your reasoning. And there is this question of all the scientific revolution and why do we need scientific tools? Even if we, because they're giving tools, why would it be like formal tools, like numbers, figures? And I mean, I get your story. But it seems there is someone missing this, and why are we looking into like science, and what is this, and what is this transformation, which is kind of a prerequisite of your story, I guess, it seems to me.
No, no, you are totally right. But the big science, what in science theory we name really the big science, is the second industrial revolution. And it's later. For example, in my field, the first license on telecom is 1876. It's the Graham Bell patent on telecom. At the same time, you have all the electricity things. And really, you can say that the second industrial revolution from this period to, let's say, 1910, when the planes were really created and so on. And around this growth of big technological things, you have the big science behind the scene, of course, until Einstein and all those people. That's absolutely key. And that gives a lot of tools even for economics. For example, look at the statistics. Pearson, you all know Pearson? I was an eugenist, a racist guy, by the way. Yeah.
This is really disturbing. Because disturbing in a sense, because this is the way someone wants to look at the history. People has always, they have always been inventing. And you, we say, putting into the perspective of the modern world as we see it, right? But not, because even if we see, even a simple invention of wheat was one of the most important human discoveries. And it was done like nobody knows who discovered the wheat. Right? And
the wheel.
With the wheel.
Yeah, of course.
It is one of the simplest discoveries that we made. And for us, it is
not in America, for example.
But it still is important. So how do we put this into perspective that one discovery, or even for universities, they became important in the form? Because this is the form that we are looking at and we are appreciating it form, because it has so, it has like, we are embedded into it or it is embedded into us. It's confusing, but there were universities, there were schools before, there were schools of thoughts, people created knowledge. Ever since the human, I think, ever since we started to be civilized, we have been creating knowledge. How knowledge is different, one knowledge is different from another knowledge, right? So it's the importance of knowledge in that particular period of time for that particular community, right?
Absolutely. Now, I totally agree with you, and what I want to go to is to explain that this vision enter in crisis today. And we are rediscovering, or discovering exactly what you said, meaning ecology. I want to explain only, if you want to look at who wrote the best about that, because they are not filled, looking at you, I can see that it's not filled you are so familiar about. You have two things to look at. One is what we named STS, Science and Technology Studies. The science and technology studies look at this kind of things, in particular the big science and all those things, you know that. To talk about more the epistemology of social science, the best, in my opinion, is someone we know, with David. His name is Wallerstein. Immanuel Wallerstein. You have very good books and articles from him about all those things. I didn't invent that this morning, waking up and saying, oh my God, David asked me to talk about something. Yeah?
Did you, okay, just another factor maybe, because you mentioned, what about the nation state? You mentioned statistics and managing, but then you need a nation state to have political economy.
Of course.
Otherwise, you have no boundaries of
Okay, the nation state, there are hundreds of books on theory about the state. Generally, in international relations, you talk about the 17th century, what we name the Westphalian order. You are all familiar with that? It's the middle of the 17th, is when in Münster, in North Germany, for the first state, first step, for example, or the first moment where the states were recognized as the only bodies able to sign peace treaty, for example. But they were not exactly modern nation states. They were really the big state, the monarchy, mainly. And then you have several steps on the construction of the state. I will not enter on that, it will be too long. But you are right, without a state, because it's the state who use the economy to transform society. And what liberalism said is that, use the state to do that. That's exactly the point. It's okay? But now, of course, to talk again about science and figures and tools for managing the society, meaning economy and then sociology, the statistics and all those branch of the mathematics were expanding at this time. For those of you who read French, there is a very good book named La Politique des Grands Nombres, The Politics of Big Numbers. I don't remember the name. You did it? Good. Good. He's a guy within STS and Science and Technology Studies. His name is Desrosiers. Exactly. It's my age. I forget names. It's a Desrosiers. For the French speakers, I don't know if it was translated in English.
It was?
Ah, good. The politics of big numbers. Read that because it's really fascinating. Because the stats were created at this time when the math and so on were at the front, at the back office, if you want, of the big science. And the first, one of the first one to use it really was Pearson, but Pearson was an eugenist. He was a racist guy. What he wanted is to know if people with long nose or whatever are really good white people or mixed people or whatever. That was his point of view. It was Hitler didn't invite the Holocaust and all those things. It was created theoretically in Britain and France through those eugenist vision. But Desrosiers reversed the perspective, and he demonstrates in his book on the statistics, how the statistic can be used to show, for example, that kids coming from a poor family have much less chance to go to the university than people coming from the rich family, and this kind of things. And through that, he helped to transform, more in the sociology way, figures to politics, to let people talk about what do we want. Do we want to see every kid able to go to the uni? How to rebalance the things. And that was through Desrosiers. And of course, this period was absolutely key to create those tools were used by liberalism. But that was a little bit before even the big science. 1848, you are really 20, 30 years before the Industrial Revolution and the big science. But you needed those tools. And the Imbold New University was very important for. If you don't know, I don't want to be too long on those issues. I'm just looking at the. But it's good to have the discussion at the same time. It's not because I don't want to talk with you. I'm just looking at the hour. Shit. Okay. 2 words about Humboldt. What Humboldt did is the division of labor. Before, the university was really from the 12th, 13th century, the Sorbonne, Oxford, Bologna, all those things. And you all know, the French speakers at least know, Abélard and Héloïse. Abélard was knowing by, in his head, 2 or 3 books, and he was telling it to his students, Héloïse being one of the students. But that was really very, very long before the 19th century. The only thing Imbold did using the medieval university is to divide the university between humanity and science. In one branch, you had medicine, astronomy, that was the beginning of science, mathematics, of course, and the other one, you had the humanities, starting by the philosophy. And every new discipline had to choose where to go, humanity or science. And it's really interesting because the first one who decided to be in one of those things were history, which is a very, very long discipline, history, thousands and thousands of years. And for a strange reason, history, which is really based in empiric fact, the thing they find everywhere, choose to be in humanity, when later, economy and sociology choose to be in science. And they create these things in the middle, named social science or whatever, in the middle of those two things. But what Wallerstein explained very well about those, because Humboldt, what he did is to have the master, let's say David or me, with 5, 6, 7 students, and we divide the work. You do that, you learn Aramean, you learn all the Hebrew, you know, you learn whatever, and we can read the whole Bible from the 2nd century after Christ. That's exactly what Humboldt imposed as a new way to work, if you want. But what Wallerstein explained, and I will come now at this issue, is that at the root of these two branches, humanity and science, is the fact that humanity is to help the students to know what is beautiful and what is good. Beautiful, the fine art. What are the beautiful, what are the non-beautiful? And the philosophy, how to get to have a good life. And in science, in the other way, is what is true and what is not true. Mathematics being the royal, if you want, discipline, because you are right or wrong. And what Wallerstein explained well is that today, in the 21st century, those two levels are in crisis for the reason you said. What's beautiful and what's good in different culture. Very different things. Very, very different things. And what Wallerstein explained well is that all these visions of the world are now crackling. And it's what I want to talk about a little bit now. What are crackling? In fact, the first thing is the fact that the model we are living in is seen as at least dysfunctional, if not totally fucked up, but at least dysfunctional. And you have a lot of theorists who look at that. If you are interested, for example, at philosophy and sociology, you have a German guy named Armand Rosa. Rosa, like the Rosa, Rosa e Rosé, for those of one of you who did Latin. And he wrote something about the acceleration of the time. His point of view is to say we have more and more tools to give us a lot of way to save time. But more and more we are needing more time. We have the impression to be in a sort of incredibly crazy machine where we are always looking for time. And he's criticizing, in fact, our model through that. He's quite criticizing the model because what he said is that it's a mix of technological acceleration, acceleration of the society, for example, the cycle of the companies, you probably learned that, are more and more quick, but also acceleration of our way to live. If you look at your grandparents, they were probably never divorced. Look at your parents, and I will not talk about you, but you can imagine what I believe. Meaning that you have a lot of chance to know in your life several big love stories, to travel a lot, you are in this master to do it, to know a lot of experience. When I was young, people were very happy to start in the same company at 18 and to finish at 65. Today, you have a lot of chance to have a lot of different jobs. And this opening society process and acceleration of the rhythm of our life, it's one of the problems Rosa was really focusing on. But you have a lot of other way to criticize the big science, say that the big science give us the atomic bomb, give us today the GMO, and so on and so on. And you have a lot of way to explain that all this vision of the world is not working so well. You saw that the last Nobel Prize, I don't remember his name, you know, the guy was nominated last week. Yeah, was trying to think at what makes people happy. And that was his starting point. We are not exactly in the liberalism and in the economy as it was generally, or it is generally teached and studied. That's why, for example, a lot of people are looking at all the other indicators than the GDP, saying that it's not enough. There is in several societies, not only in France, a lot of people who believe that we cannot rely only on the GDP and growth. You have a lot of people thinking that degrowth has at least to be discussed. A lot of people would believe that you have new way to do economy, like circular economy, collaborative economy. Probably you did that or you will do it in your courses. A lot of things who are challenging this vision that the only thing we have to do is the sort of line of progress, the GDP being in economy the best indicator, and that's it. And doing this kind of self-criticizing process of our society, of course, we are finding other culture and other vision of the world. Because at the center of the Enlightenment and then liberalism, you have a vision of the men, humankind, let's say, and often men, of course, but humankind dominated everything, dominating everything. The beginning of the Enlightenment is so often described as the Descartes vision, and Descartes put the human being at the center of everything. You have a lot of, I give you names like that, if you're interested, you can go to look after. A lot of anthropologists, one of the last one is a French one named Descola. Some of you know a little bit, you know a little bit him. Descola is a very interesting anthropologist. He wrote a book, which is also a 30-page resume, if you want summary, named Nature and Culture. And what he explained is that you have different ways to see the relation between human and nature. You have, of course, our Western way, meaning humankind dominating and everything and exploiting the nature. And we'll talk about when we'll talk about the green economy, because one part of that. But you have other part of the world. Look at the animism. You all saw the movie, probably Avatar. It was one of the big hits the last years. In Avatar, look how the people, the kind of arborigenous people living in this planet, have a relation with human being, between human being and non-human being. You have in here in this planet something named animism, which is a little bit that. The spirits pass from one thing to the other. You have other vision possible. I will not do a big course about this scholar. It will be too long. But people are rediscovering that. And rediscovering that, they are talking about new approaches. The new approaches are circular economy. They are collaborative economy. They are new indicators. And one of the things people are talking about is the commons. If you agree, we can stop. I will say a little bit about the commons, why it's so important today. It's okay? And then you will have the job to present the text, and then we have a discussion. The commons start by a real problem of the 20th century. I forget the 18th. The people who were challenging capitalism in the end of the 19th century, in 20th century, were in fact in the same vision of the world. And they use also the same kind of tool, of course, with a strong critics against all the neoclassic economy and all those things. But they were, as the liberalism people, as the liberal in politics people, convinced that what we have to do is to have tools to change the society. And the main separation, if you want to be really very, very schematic, I have not so much time. You have, in one hand, capitalism. Capitalism, of course, is based in private property. Property. Of course, in market mechanism. In profit. You have a lot of keywords you can add like that, who are obvious. But against that, the people who claim themselves as socialists, and when I say socialists, it's from the social democrat, but not the today social democrat in the 30s, 40s, to Trotskyist, Maoist, anarchist, passing by the communist, and all those branches. My point is not to do the differentiation between them, it's not the point. But when you were talking about socialism, you were talking about nationalization of the economy. You were talking, meaning that you have an opposition to private property. You were talking about planification of the economy, to not let the market to do everything. You were talking about public service instead of profit, and so on and so on. You can add other keywords as well. But this opposition was the key element of the debate of the 20th century. And you can look at all the theorists you want, which is not the 19th century. Marx was not at all a nationalization guy or a planification guy, not at all. Proudhon, even farther. But in the 20th century, that was clear. That was the big battle between those two worlds. The problem is the fact that the critic of that is still on. And David and me, we can add critics to critics, no problem. We can pass hours to tell you what all those things create, inequalities, poverty, and so on and so on. But at the same time, these things is not seen so attractive and appealing today. You perhaps know someone named Kautsky. I don't know if you know his name, Karl Kautsky. Someone knows him? If you are interested by the story of ideas, he's very important. He was really the pope, the theorist pope, if you want, of the Second International, meaning the Social Democrat International. He was really the theorist of the German Social Democrat Party in the beginning of the 20th century, between 19 and 1914, 14 years of domination, intellectual domination. And Germany was the mecca of socialism. Never forget that. Really, Germany was all the socialists we are looking at. And Kautsky was the main guy. Kautsky, for example, he had a formula. When people ask him, what's socialism, in fact? Have you a brief explanation of what's socialism? He said, oh, it's very simple. Socialism is the railway administration at the scale of the society. You imagine what's a railway administration, and you organize the society as a railway administration. Is the society you really want to live in? Not so sure. But I'm sure that if you are in this market, you are not very happy neither about inequalities, poverty, and all the things created by the neoliberal capitalist system. And people try to look at what other models are possible. There are several. I will not do a big course because I will not have the time. But let's say that the commons are useful to try to find a third way. I don't know how Benjamin Coria described the commons, but for me, the commons are really a social relation. It's a mode of management. It's only that. It's not at all the governance. It's not at all a fact. Because some people say the water is a common, air is a common. That's absurd. Water doesn't need us, and the air was there before us, and no problem. You don't need the human relation, humankind for that. It's when we are managing the relation with water. We want to clean the water, we want to use the water for, I don't know, agriculture or other purpose, that you could do it in a socialist, nationalized way, meaning a state power, public service. A market way, or a common. The idea that you have a lot of things which will be seen and managed as commons. Now, looking at the time, I have not a big amount of time, but I will give you some example of what could be seen as commons. Historically, there were all the Middle Age European commons were part of the forest, some field in which when the farmers were able to go with their cow, or goats, sheep, or whatever. These things exist in a lot of other continents, even if they don't use the same term of commons, but in Asia, in Africa, in Latin America, you had a lot of collective lands were managed in the same way. It's not at all an European story only, even if the name comes from the European Middle Age. Through this Middle Age, you can say that the cooperatives are also a form of commons. Because they use the same idea that you can manage in common a company against the private power of the bosses of the first industrial revolution. You can say that. But those commons were the historical farmer commons and the cooperative of the 19th century disappear a little bit at the end of the 19th century and were replaced by this vision. The reason why they were replaced by these visions are, in my opinion, quite interesting. The first reason is because, of course, through the big science, through the big state, you had the idea that you need to have big companies managed by the top. When Kautsky was talking about the administration of the railway, the scale of the society, the consequences is you have to have an architect to organize everything like that, or a big engineer. This vision of the world was not at all the vision of the common of the Middle Age or the common of the cooperative, meaning that was really forgotten. There is another reason who interests me is the relationship between the way to organize a society and the fundamental rights. You know that in the history and the family of the fundamental right, we generally say that there is a first generation coming from the American and French Revolution, the Declaration des droits de l'homme et du citoyen, Citizen and Human Rights Declaration in Europe, in France, for example, who are all the civic or civil rights. The right to speak, the right to organize, the right to demonstrate, all those rights. That you had in the 19th century the emergence of a second generation, all the social rights, the right to have access to education, the right to housing, the right to have a job, the right to whatever. The difference between the right to and to have, and the, in French we said les droits de et les droits à, which is two ways to look at the right. Those second generation of rights were theorized, if you want, by the United Nations, the Universal Declaration of the Human Rights in 1948, after the Second World War, and just at this time, not before. But of course, in the socialist perspective, those rights were important. How to be sure that your kid go to school, how to be sure to have a health system, and whatever, whatever. And at this time, the commons were not able to address those fundamental rights. Only the state was able to do it, starting by Germany again. Bismarck started the first, you know, that social, what we named the welfare state in 1880s, long, long, long ago, 140 years ago. That explains why the commons disappeared. But why they are coming back today? First, because of knowledge. Knowledge in a globalized world become a huge asset. Probably you have teaching on that. For example, the brands are very important. I'm working in Orange, and the only pride of Orange being having bought France Telecom, having bought the British company named Orange is a brand. They are very happy to have the brand Orange. Coca-Cola is very happy, and so on and so on. The brands are very important in knowledge. But behind that, it's all the patents, all those kind of things who are absolutely key when the production is the same. Today, all the cars are the same. The only thing who makes the difference is a little bit the patent, but mainly the brand. And all those things are about knowledge. This kind of privatization of knowledge created a counter reaction. All the free software movement, you know, all the free content movement. And you have a huge movement to make knowledge as a common. Free software, Wikipedia, free content in general. That you know that. But that immediately has an implication. The right to knowledge can be addressed today through the commons. Meaning that new fundamental rights are possible to be given to the whole world through a common approach and not to a state approach. You know, for example, that the internet world, there is a big fight to know if internet has to be managed by the United Nations or not. Today is not. And I defend the fact that it's not at all managed by the United Nations. I can explain why the worst will be to have the internet managed by the United Nations. Because today, internet is a common. Wikipedia is a common. All those things are managed by you and me. More Wikipedia than the internet, of course. Internet requires more technical knowledge than what you have. But I'm sure that who here write time to time in Wikipedia? 3, 4. Who write in Wikipedia time to time, even a word? Raise your hand, we'll count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5. We are a little bit more than the average. Everyone read Wikipedia in the, at least in the university in the world. And you have a little bit less than 10% while writing even a word to correct, I don't know, spelling or stupid things, and not to write big, big articles. But you see, we are 4 here to do it. You are 35, we are a little bit more than 10%, which is normal because you are in a master. There is sociological reason, we explain why. But if we all, not the readers are okay, they read, but if the 4 people who are here stop to write in Wikipedia, in 20 years' time, Wikipedia is dead. Because you need to update in permanence those things. That we need to have those 4 people or the 10% of the... it's also an encouragement for the others. Don't be shy. Do it. Do it. Knowledge become a common and is able to address fundamental rights. And now nature. Of course. Because when you have few humans in the planet, it's quite easy to say, okay, nature is limited. There is a so big abundance of tree, of forest, of water, of pure air, and whatever, no problem. Today, we start to see that the planet has limits. And the management of the natural goods, when we have to manage them, meaning the water, when you have to water some agriculture field or whatever, or to have clean air in a city, meaning that you have the possibility to manage it as a common. That, I think, it's why the commons are becoming so important today in the, even in the economical field. The proof is the Benjamin Correa teaching. But I will not be more long than that, because it's okay for you? But I suppose I was really brief on the comment because I'm sure that you had already a lot of things about that. It's only to explain a little bit one of the new branch, showing that economies being in crisis at the same time couldn't be used in a different way. David wanted absolutely me to talk about that. Here is my mail if you have a question to ask me, no problem. Here is the website, of course, www before, of the French Coalition on Climate. I suppose, I will not start by that, that you all know that climate change is a big challenge for humanity, and that our activities are very key on the climate issue. And the warming is not coming from God or whatever, it's from ourselves. Okay, that you all know. You all know, I am sure, that the consequences of the global warming are already there. It will be worse in 50 years when you will be old, but today we are seeing it. Okay, I will not be more long on that. You all know, I am sure, that the consequences for some region of the world will be quite terrible. I'm thinking at cities, Shanghai, New York, big cities like that with 2 meters more, the city are dead. You have big cities who are really at the limit. Today it's okay because the water, of the level of the sea is only a few centimeters more. But with that more, problem. And with 2 meters and of those big cities, the consequences, even for the economy, are absolutely incommensurable. Incommensurable. Okay, that you are supposed, I suppose you all know. I will not enter on that. What's interesting is to see what will happen this year. That you probably don't know. There is something at the COP21. Who knows what COP mean? One. COP? Now, everyone knows that there is a climate summit in Paris. If you don't know, you will know, because you have hundreds of articles and things in the TV, in the radio, no problem. But what COP means? One knows, two. Yeah, I suppose you knew as well, we are three. COPs, it's a French acronym, meaning Conference of Parties. Conference of Parties. What are those parties? They are not political parties, ni party, neither party when you dance and drink. The parties in the UN system. But first of all, perhaps I have to start before that. Do you know when the COP and the climate summit start to be held and raised up? The first one, when they start, what happened? No, okay, a little bit of explanation, that's good. It's not exactly economy, even but a little bit. It's more international relations and politics, but it's useful also for you. 1992. What happened in the world in 1992 was so important. Rio, Brazil.
The president of France went there using two planes, two Concorde.
Yeah. Okay, 92, it's an important date for the environmental issue, but it's also interesting, not important, but interesting, because 1 year before, something very important happened. It's the end of the USSR. The USSR collapsed in 91. The Berlin Wall in 89, and in 2 years, the whole system disappeared. And that opened a very short period in history when you had, at the same time, the victory of neoliberalism, if you want, what we named the Washington Consensus, I suppose that you had teaching about that, but also the belief that multilateralism will run the world. Today, it looks strange because every big power arrive in Syria and bomb everywhere and whatever. But at this time, it was not at all like that. The US was seen as a declining power. And you had the idea that you can run the world in a democratic and multilateral way. And for the oldest here, they know that. But we had a big, big number of international conferences organized by the United Nations. 95 Copenhagen on social issue, Beijing on the women rights, Cairo in the population, Istanbul on the habitat, Copenhagen on the social issue. all those big, big, big conferences were seen as a way to reorganize the world in a multilateral way. But this period was very short. It's 91 to 97. 97, end of the story. But during this period, there was a 92, the Earth Summit, is what the people are naming. We were creating three branches of negotiation. One is biodiversity. The Nagoya conference, if you remember that, and biodiversity. One in desertification, which is the less well-known, but it's an important one even. And the third one is the climate. And the frame is named FUNFCCC, United Nations Frame on Convention on Climate Change. UNFCCC. In French, you said, but no one will use it except this year. La Convention cadre des Nations Unies sur le changement de climat, CCNUCC. UNFCCC. That's what the people use as acronym. These UNFCCC start to have COP 21 years ago. Exactly. Huh? Because you have one COP every year in December, the two first weeks of December. COP means Conference of Parties, but I didn't answer to the question what parties are, except they are not parties with pizza and beer. Those parties are the people able to sign the agreement. They are not exactly state. They are state or block of state. You have 194 states in the UNFCCC process, and 194 less 27, because European Union are acting as one, meaning that it's 177 parties. Those parties sign agreement. But why you name them parties? In the UN system, you don't talk about parties, but state. Because, and that again, it's related to the common. That's why there is a little link. When you mixed up politics, international relations, and technology or science, you cannot let the chief of state act again alone. Because there are a lot of things they are not able to understand and to manage. That's why you need to have a sort of multi-stakeholder, whatever you name it, approach. And in the UNFCCC, you have the scientists, for example, what we name in French, the GIEC. In English, you say the International IPCC, International Panel on Climate Change. IPCC. They are very important, because they give you the scientific background to understand what's happening. But you have also what we name the major groups. The major groups are the civil society. And they are organized in the way the UN system sees the civil society. You have the ENGOs, who are the environmental NGOs. You have the indigenous caucus. You have the women caucus. You have the youth. There's a big youth caucus. But you have also the local authorities. And you have also the Congo. The Congo is not this country around Central Africa. Huh? What's Congo anyway? Someone have an idea? Oh, it's very simple, I will not let you. Corporate NGOs, corporations. Huh? All those people are part of the UNFCCC, which is a very strange thing. You know that in the COP21, we will have 43 or 45,000 people accredited in the conference during 2 weeks. 2 weeks conference with 45,000 people is quite a lot. Huh? We have to work by consensus. Like in the internet, it's the same system than the internet, in fact. Huh? Those 45,000 to 43,000 people are three or five. No one knows exactly how many will join. Journalists. But we already know that there is 20,000 people from the states, government, states, and so on, and 20,000 people from the civil society. All those people will meet during 2 weeks, from the 30th of November to the 11th of December. And it's really an important issue. And today, what the United Nations decided, the UNFCCC, is to try to do in Paris what they were unable to do in Copenhagen 6 years ago. I will not tell you all the history, but after Rio in 92, in 97, you had the Kyoto Protocol. Signed in Kyoto, Japan. And why 97 for me is the end of this multilateral world? It was under the Clinton administration. The Clinton administration was Al Gore, the vice president, signed Kyoto, but the Congress didn't ratify. And we can say that symbolically is the beginning of the end of the multilateralism. For example, all the UN big conference finished. And you have today and 2003, invasion of Iraq was the paroxysm of that, a sort of unilateralism coming back. US first, of course, but also China, Russia, whatever. And US being leading this process. But that was the end of this short period of both neoliberalism at economical level and at political level or international relation level, multilateralism. Okay, Copenhagen was Kyoto. I will not enter in the details. The only thing to know about Kyoto, which is important, that they decided to use market mechanism to quantify what is the emission of green gas, which is a critic. People like me are not very happy with that. But at the same time, they based the agreement on very good principles. The first principle, which is very good, is to say that the climate change is under the common but differentiated responsibility of the international community. Meaning that it's a problem, that's why it's common for the entire world. You can live in Alaska, in Japan, in Australia, wherever, you will be affected. Meaning that it's really a humankind problem. It's not like a war, even a world war will affect only some part of the world. It's every us, every one of us. But at the same time, some countries are more responsible than others. The one who are emitting green gas emission for 100 and century and a half or whatever. 150 years or one century and a half. That was the principle of Kyoto. In Copenhagen in 2009, they wanted to create a new agreement who collapsed totally. And today, the UNFCCC wants to achieve in Paris an agreement, an international agreement. I will not be too long, only know that the risk to not work is quite strong. We can have that in the discussion. But the most important for you is to know that there is a huge coalition at French and international level where you have all the families of the civil society. You have all the environmental groups from Greenpeace to Friends of the Earth or whatever. You have all the more anti-globalization groups like ATTAC and groups like that. You have all the unions from Sud Union, come from, as you say, to the CFDT passing by CGT and others. You have all the, what we name the groupe de foi, the believers, if you want, Catholic, Protestant, but also Mason, who are another kind of, it's not exactly a religion, para-religion, whatever you want. you have a lot of people like that. That's the civil society coalition. And you will find everything here. And I really encourage you, in particular for the people who are, I suppose the French know that already, but for the non-French, to go there, because a lot of things will be translated. You will be there, because it's between the 29. We will have in Paris a big demo the 29th of November. Then we'll have a sort of huge social forum and a village of alternative in Montreuil the 5th and the 6th of December, the weekend. Then the last week between the 7th and the 11th, we have a place named the 104, the 104. You all know? You were there? Okay, we have the whole 104 for the civil society. It's big. We'll have General Assembly every evening to mobilize everyone. More than welcome. And we have again a big demo and activities at the end of the process, the 12th of December. And it's a good chance for you to meet a lot of French young people, activists or whatever, and to be part of a quite historical mobilization of the civil society.
Thank you.
That's what I wanted to tell you.
Okay, hello everyone. It was really the challenging intro to our presentation, but if you saw on our website, we had one article to read, and so we will, in our presentation, we will summarize it a bit. First, I will start for the content of our presentation. It looks like this. First, we will make a short, very short summary of the article. Then I will follow with a green economy, and Sébastien with the rights of nature, list of references, and the most interesting questions. So, okay. Sébastien?
Okay, so this was the article we talked about. And the main issues are, as we all know, like the problem of climate change and what you talked about with UNFCCC problems and this COP21 issue. So Solon is a researcher from Bolivia, I guess. I don't remember well, I think. From Bolivia, yeah. And so in the article, basically the main data were, I think many people knows, but that we could, the temperature could raise for more than 2 degrees in the next, until 2050, and that's a big problem for all. Like, everyone knows that, obviously. And so the scientific community had said that we have to reduce it into 44 gigaton of gas emission if we want to stay sustainable. And basically the political measures which were implemented were not enough because the target was 57 gigaton until 2050, and so it's really a matter of emergency according to the Solon's view. And in this article, the difference is two approach to deal with the problem. The first one is the green economy, which will be presented by Kateryna. And so we basically disagree with this approach. She will tell you why. And so he said that basically we should consider nature as a partner and with its own rights and not as something useful for humankind, which would be above it. So that's the main idea for this.
Yeah, I will continue. And okay, here you can see this. We were talking about it in intro also, but the main aim of this slide is to show how the concept of green economy appears. And according like to our logic, the first sign for that was in 1983 when United Nations creates the World Commission of Environment and Development. And then this commission published the report, which will be taken as a basis for the Earth Summit in Rio. Okay, then where's the term green economy pops up at first? It was in 1989 in a book, but it was not explicitly defined. More about green economics, we started her in 2007, 2008, when it's like a financial crisis. So we have prices for food rising, prices of fuel rising, and this helps to push the notion of green economy on the top of the political agenda. Then in 2008, United Nations creates Green Economy Initiative, which is the main purpose of existing is to support and with analysis and policy making of creation green economy in the different states. They published a report, Global Green New Deal, which is taken as a basis for Rio+20. And next in this logic would be the crop, probably will crop this year. But what we also wanted to mention that in first Rio, it was the most very important because sustainable development comes as a new title of development concept. And Agenda 21 was agreed on Agenda 21. Can you please? Summarizing this slide, we wanted to say that green economy is a political notion that derives from another political notion, what is sustainable development. And this sustainable development has huge success in a political and in ideological way. Can you please take it? Thank you. Now we will talk about definition of green economy, which is taken from United Nations. So green economy results in improvement human well-being, social equity, while significantly reducing environmental risk and ecological scarcities. So basically, it is low carbon, social inclusive, and resource efficient economy. With two very distinguishing features, it's a direct evaluation of natural capital and ecological services, and full cost accounting regime. What means that we're taking more thoughtfully the pricing mechanism of the natural resources concerning negative externalities. Can you please continue? Here we continue with the main components of green economy. There are five main components. First one, I think the most interesting for us, it's managing natural capital. Because here they're talking about rising and new markets of this ecological services. And this part takes a lot of critics because it's telling us that nature provides us with services and we have to pay for it as if it would be provided by a company or organization. For example, you can measure how much does it cost for insects to provide the services, like to make fruit fill our agriculture, for example. They really can calculate it. They did in their reports. In this first component, they also talking about what is interesting because it's very close to commons. They're talking about community ownership of natural assets. They're also talking about rural jobs that concerning green economy. Second one in it's investment in people. Third component is greening economical sectors. Basically, it is about mostly using sustainable energy source. Also about environmental innovations. Fourth, influencing financial flows. And fifth, the last one, improving governance and measurement. Actually, it is some kind of reframing. What is it government and what is it progress and development as it is? And now it's the last slide in my part, interesting one, because here comes limits and critics. So first limit, I would say, according to United Nations Environmental Programme, transforming into a green economy provide us with even higher rate of growth than before. So basically, that is why we need a green economy, because it's help us to maintain and even to increase the rate of growth. But here the question, because it's not very logical, how it is possible to have unlimited growth in really limited planet? Because in my economic logic, it's you produce more, you consume more, you use more resources. It's not very possible to have unlimited growth. Second one is that the green economy is just masking exploitation and power relation. Basically, it is showing that there is no room in this concept for some kind of class, gender, or ethnic sensitivity. Or any general question concerning labor division in a global scale. Third part is that green economy favors market-based instrument. Basically, it's a very capitalistic way to measure and to put everything on the market and make market founded on equilibrium. But if we look on real examples, like for example, this in article we had this example of RED. RED is a program for decreasing deforestation. So the main purpose of this RED is to give the monitor reason to decrease deforestation. But in reality, what is happening in this kind of markets, it is speculation. And basically, it's just permission for corporation or, I would say, rich states to pollute, or in this case, deforestate. Fourth example of critics, it's that green the concept of green economy based on technological approach. So they use these magical words like resource efficiency that can be achieved by innovations. Of course, they don't specify which kind of which innovations, but even though we dig deeper, we will take to consideration this huge gap between technological gap between the global north and global south, and we can see that for developing countries it is really hard to catch up this gap, and it would be more expensive. So this green economy really favors and works for developed countries. Five, it's this more like sociological part, that then socialist based societies take their decision on a democratic basis. They are not always or not mostly based on a value that market gives them. In the huge questions, when it's very important for societies, they also take social concerns and environmental concerns, not always works like a market. And last one, what was very shown in the article that we had, it was commodification of nature. So actually, the elements of nature, like water, atmosphere, or biodiversity, is the price is put in on them, and now you can trade, buy and sell. What is not very nice looking in the ethical and moral issues. And now I'm finishing, and I will pass to Sebastian. But what I wanted to say in response to intro, that really you can criticize capitalism and criticize socialism or communism, let's say. But there is an option, another sort of an option. For example, we can look on it, and I think Sebastian will tell you more about it. It's an bon vivir, it's called bon vivir, and it's like nothing like capitalism or socialism. It's living in the harmony of nature. It's something that Bolivia promoting, and they put in their constitution, yes, and you will hear about it more. So yeah, please be listening carefully.
So yeah, my part will be essentially about rights of nature, because it's the alternative to the green economy we just criticized, basically, according to Solon. So I just summarized some actions that have been taken concerning this rights of nature approach. First, it was in the 80s in the Ecuadorian constitution. As you can read, they gave basically inalienable rights, to exist, persist, maintain, and regenerate its vital cycles to nature. So it's basically giving rights to nature as we would give rights to people. And so after that, there was also the Bolivia constitution's reform, which led to a UN approach also stated by Bolivia, which will I develop later. And there's also, I found some webs on the internet talking about some US cities which are trying to implement such a system, which basically give incentives to people to just take flows necessary for their health. So it's very difficult to define, but anyway, the approach is like this. So it's existing also. The UN approach, given by first by Bolivia. I just summarized the first things. The Butlan paradigm was already told by Kateryna. So I won't talk a lot about it. So it was the general approach from 1972 until the Brundtland paradigm, which was like sustainable development. So it was the first approach, but there's also like alternative ones, much more close with the rights of nature paradigm. So yeah, the main problem was, and we could see in this whole UN approach, which was first it was implemented in a very political Western Union, as you say, like humanism way of thinking, which was mainly with political problem. For example, inside the negotiation regarding this topic was the indigenous problem in some countries. So we could see that basically states are like conserving their interests in the process. We are not like in another paradigm, they're staying in the same way of thinking. And anyway, there was like a huge step forward also. You talk about the Rio Summit 1992. Which made like state closer to making a serious commitment for this rights of nature process thinking. So, but the main problem, as many UN problem, is that it stays a principled stance. There is no system of sanction of punishment if states doesn't follow their engagement. And so what I try to do here is thinking on how could we act, actually. You're an activist with the union, so how could we concretely act further than just principles and from the UN process? So maybe from a scientific point of view, it's interesting to know that there is some very recent article showing that for example, ANSO, which is the the big Pacific flows for the which in the coast of South America, which is every 3 or 4 years, I guess. And so some biologists and physicians show that it had a role in 21% of conflict in South America since 1950. And also another article try to define also with another method the show that the widening of probable conflict would be by 54% in Africa until 2030 because of the climate change problem, the desertification problem. Also, for example, in Syria, we know that maybe it's just an hazard, but it would be really strange because, for example, the revolution in 2011 came after 4 years of desertification, which were the biggest year of desertification since we know the region, basically. So, and there is also the same for Egypt revolution, which was the main, some agricultural importators, and there was a problem in China, which raised the price of, multiplied the price by 3, and just after that, there was a problem. So the main point is that it shows that scientifically that climate could alter the stability of modern society. So maybe by this approach we could, speaking on the same level as political interest as today, like when you heard in the, like if I take France for example, the main political topics are migrations problem, geopolitic problem, that kind of stuff. So maybe by approaching with this topics, we could talk on the same level as some politics problem today and be more implicated in the process. Also, how to spread the message from scientific world to population. We talked about IPCC, you talked about it before, and there was a study just this year, actually, which shows that IPCC, even though it's really scientifically strong, has a problem of spread of the message because it's really difficult to read and really it has a too much technical level. And there is this graph which is kind of interesting. You show on the right of the, is it? Yeah, kind of. So on this it's like tabloid and it's the more readable stuff because, you know, basically everyone can read tabloid. And so the IPCC is way beyond a normal scientific process, which means that, okay, they are making good work to show us that there is a problem, but nobody can read it. So I was wondering, it's one of the questions, how could we, how could scientific world be able to match better with common society, basically? Also, if we, now I'm forecasting anyway, but if we try to reflect on, maybe we would get someday in the right of nature process and not in green economy, how could we implement that? And many stuff show that, many articles show that, okay, the main approach is like, we will first implement a law, and then after that, the economical and sociological change will come. But as maybe it's also you, Pandrevi, I don't know, because your introduction was really idealist point of view and not materialist point of view. My point is, we could maybe, and it's a question for you, is it possible that as a materialist you could say, okay, first the change should come from economic change and sociological change, and then the law will follow later? Like, I won't make a course on materialism, but it's the main idea, like Marxist idea of how could we, is it by the law or is it by the economical and sociological change? So the feedback loop is this kind of stuff, like, in the feedback loop vision, we have first the law, then the economical change, and then against a change in the law extra. But is this is the original point the law or the economical material changement, I mean? So this is the list of reference we use, anyway. Maybe you like to ask your questions and then...
No, I think you already asked a lot. We're just happy that we are discussing, so we can...
Yeah. As you know.
So I think you, maybe you asked already a few questions. So
yeah,
maybe
yeah.
Maybe you can answer, and then we will continue with this one. I think we're very good with time, so we have.
No problem.
Okay, so you want to answer? You want to ask?
No, so first question, previous one.
Yeah, it was this one. How could you think the scientific world could match better with the? That's the society to, you know, give some legitimacy to this problem and spread the message. You know.
You want me to answer to that?
Yeah. Your vision about this problem, because
now for the people who don't know what the IPCC does, there is three sections. IPCC is more or less 2,000 researchers all over the world, in every countries of the world until now. And they are volunteer, they are not paid. They are generally academic, who are paid by the university or whatever research center. And they are divided in three sections. The first section, which is the most difficult to read, is the thermodynamic of atmosphere, meaning how the global atmosphere around the world is changing through the green gas emission increase and all those things. Don't even try to read that. You can read the conclusion, but it's extremely technical or in the scientific and very difficult to read. The second section, the first one, it's difficult to read, but it's the most certain in the sense of it's the most hard science, and they are sure of what they said. For example, they know that you have today 10 days to have a repartition. For example, you emit green gas here in the street because you have a car or whatever. After 10 days, it's in the global atmosphere. And they know now that these things will stay as sort of toxic during 1,000 years. Those things are now demonstrated, and they have a lot of proof about that. Don't ask me why. I'm not at all a scientist in this field, but they are very good at, and they are sure of what they say. And they said when they don't know, they said, okay, we have an uncertainty on that, but more and more they are sure. The second section is more uncertain. It's the consequences of this global transformation of the thermodynamic of the atmosphere toward the field. Meaning, what kind of rain will we have tomorrow in France? We know that we are talking about 3 degrees, passing from 14 to 17, but those 3 degrees are not everywhere the same. What are the places of the world where those 3 degrees will be 5, 6, or only 1? Will we see Africa being desert or not? In fact, not, paradoxically. At the beginning, the people thought yes, but until now, no. Because one of the first effects of the global warming is the increase of the precipitation, the waterfall. Where this waterfall will fall? Do the, I don't know if you are from India, but do the moon, how do they say, monsoon?
Monsoon.
Be there or not? Which is key, if there is none, bye-bye India. It's a little bit wrong, but good luck. those things, they have indication and they are whatever, but it's less sure than the thermodynamic of the atmosphere in the globe. And the third section is the soft science, if you want, is sociology and economy, the kind of bullshit we are working in, you and me. Meaning that those thing is not very sure at all, of course, but it at the same time it's true that we know that if Shanghai and New York are flooded, China and the US will pay a strong price, of course. And that's the third section. Of course, it's difficult to read, but frankly, if you look at all the articles the journalists and the newspaper are publishing, it's quite simple to read. You probably read some, it's accessible.
Yeah. May I add a question maybe related to this? What do you think about all this literature about collapsology? Because there is a kind of this literature that is just hurting people in a different way. So maybe you could say something. I know that it's in this room, someone has been very shocked to read.
Yeah, you have always the idea that with the complex theory, you can have a sort of tipping point. That what you talk about is all the, or what is his name, this book, it was very famous 5 years ago, you know, about the Maya, the collapse of the Maya civilization, the Pack Island, you know.
Jared
Diamond, that's it, huh? This kind of theories. Of course, when you read it, you are very impressed. Then you think, oh my God, it's a joke. But at the same time, there are so much uncertainty. For example, today they are looking, that's really in the hard science, in the first section. They are looking at one of the way they have to look at the past is to extract from Antarctica a huge carrot of ice and to look what was happening 10,000 years ago, 20,000 years ago, 30,000 years ago, and so on and so on. And you know perhaps this catastrophe movie when you have a global warming and the icing of the planet, in particular the North. They finish in a library and they are waiting in a library. What's the name? Yeah, whatever. It's the blockbuster. but now there is an article from some of the hard scientist people telling, be careful, because in between the two last glaciations, you had an episode who looked a little bit like that. And the only thing I want to say is don't take that too seriously, but don't think that it's totally crazy. Because one of the arguments of the people who are very worried is the fact that if the ice calotte, the big ice, I don't know how you said calotte, glaciers of Antarctica, part of the Antarctica, it's only half of the Antarctica will disappear, and Greenland, if those two things melt, it will be 70 meters more in the sea. Meaning it's not only New York and Shanghai, but a lot of other cities. That, there is no certainty on that. But they said careful, because it's true that the people who look at the ice, for example, the Greenland, say that the melting is much quicker than they thought. But yeah, they don't know if that will follow like that or not. But yeah.
And we are happy to be presenting.
I think this topic has a lot of questions.
Ask all your questions. You will gather the questions and answer.
Can I argue, because I was looking I was looking video from previous year and I was thinking it is not working. I have a high probability not listening the response to my question. So I
he's the boss. I'm only the sub boss.
I remember that last year we decided a little bit late, but we will do it since the next seminar. One of you will take the precedence of the session in order to keep time for the presenter and the discussion. So totally agree.
We have still 1 hour.
I heard about the last seminar, which was interesting, but a little bit longer than planned initially. So ask your question all together, and if he doesn't answer something, we will tell back.
Okay. We have two sections again. So first is more about green economics, so it's mine part, and second about rights of nature and Sebastian. My question, first one, if green economy is like for good, for real, if it's not only on paper but it's like in real, does it mean that we change the paradigm of this growth, production, consumption paradigm? And the second one, you already talk a bit about it, but still, Kyoto Protocol, it's an example of this commodification of nature. Do we have other options? And how it can be in the future developed? Maybe for good or so? Next one.
Okay, so all these questions actually sub-question of this one, so there was only one question. So
what system you are talking about?
The hypothetical right of nature system, law system. Okay. I mean, so yeah, there's like supposing we could implement such a system, how to make this work actually? Because, as you said, for example, it's beyond us, but we're all parts of this humanism Descartes process, and so we all make the assumption naturally that we are above nature. It's like this. And so making a hierarchy between Earth and nature. And by loop, we could say that also in the nature, we made a hierarchy according to the criterion. My point is, for example, if I saw someone throwing garbage on the Mount Everest or on Monument Valley, it's not the same that if I see someone throwing garbage in a Belgium field, you know? It's like this. There's some natural hierarchy. So how to make this work with this symbolic hierarchy we have in our brain, basically. And so with all the system, all to do is with ABUS, who will deal with the system? Is it a coordinated international organization or are these the states? What kind of sanctions? Is it proportional to the gravity, et cetera, et cetera? So just a general point of view. Do you have something in your head that could be implemented? That's it.
Okay, you understood, Christophe, that you have to answer all the questions.
I know. Thanks for the question. No, they are good. First one, the green economy, but you explained it well. It's a way to re-internalize externalities, if you want. And the good example you gave is the orchard, the trees, the fruit trees. You know that without bees, you don't have fruit, or very few. And the bees are absolutely key for the fruit trees. Perhaps you knew or you know that in China there is a region when you have fruit trees, but the pollution is so high that there is no bees anymore. What they do instead? There is women, again, because they are the most exploited and less well paid, who go with brush, and they do flower by flower. And they put their brush with some etamines and pollens and so on, and they do it flower by flower. Of course, there are women, which is less important, and there are Chinese, which is less and less important, meaning they are very badly paid. But they are paid. Or at least they are working in the field.
Can I interrupt? Because it's very, very interesting. Because it's a real case.
No, it's a real case, I confirm.
It's a real case, and actually people who are doing this working with brush, they are more productive than bees, but more expensive. So the price of apples going up according to the price of people who are doing this. And then it was like in the region, in China, was very famous for this like cheap apples and now it's not cheap at all. So they are starting changing their economical activity. So now it's not apples anymore. So bees are not so easy. It's not just a service of the. It's very
practical, huh? Okay, meaning that look at this example we both know. that means that you can give a price. The job of the bees have a price, because the women are able to replace the bees. Even better. Even better. Okay, now we can commodify the nature. We can do the same with green gas and growing forest or whatever, whatever. That's the idea, the general idea of the green gas. And you explained it very well, the exposé was very good. What the people want to do in green economy, you have two aspects. One is the good people who say it's not normal to see bastards wasting water, polluting air, letting the pollution kill all the bees and whatever, and we have to oblige them to be good and for that to give price. Okay, that is the good way. And for part, there is a little bit of truth on that. There is a little bit of truth. But what other people explain, which is the case of Pablo Solon, which is very against that, is that, in fact, in 92, one of the things the Rio conference did is to divide the nature in two. One part of the nature was commodified. The crop, the wheat, the fruit are commodities today. You have a price of the crop in Chicago, and you have every year you know what's the price of the crop. It's a commodity. It's like iron, petrol, whatever. Whatever are the consequences for the people who have to eat it, by the way. But they are commodities. But in Rio, they decided, in particular through the biodiversity Nagoya process, that there is a part of the nature which is not a commodity, which is supposed to be pure, intact, protected. And the only thing we can do it in as human being is to study the nature, to go there with microscope and scientists, but that's it, and to protect it through the biodiversity in Nagoya process and so on. What the people who are against the green economy concept say, hey, be careful. Because through that, this new concept of green economy, you are commodifying the whole nature. You are finishing the job was not finished in Rio. You are transforming everything in commodities. But the problem of commodity, and you are economists, you know that, is that you go where the commodity gives you the best profit. And immediately you will get that in nature. Meaning that if you find a sort of bee, which is much better than the Chinese woman, and of course much better than the other kind of bees were there before, you will do the priority to the bee, or it's a little bit difficult to get the bees. But look at the trees. You will put eucalyptus everywhere or whatever. Yeah? And the consequences for nature will be very bad, because instead of letting nature having its own cycles and so on, you will decide, according to the price, what's the best. That the core critics of the commodification of the rest of the nature is that by acting like that, giving a price to everything will reorient the use of nature. If you want to see that as a whole. Then the second question was about Kyoto Protocol. Kyoto Protocol was signed at a time where the world was very different than today. In 97, I think that the external trade of China was much less than the external trade of Belgium. And the green gas emission from China at this time was very little, very little. Today, you know that China is the first emitter in the world, 2 times more than the US. One of the main reasons, there is 2 main reasons. One is because we, the European, the American, so on, exporting there. Our industry, our factories, and they are emitting the green gas we stop to emit because our clothes, computer, and so on are done there, and not here. That's one reason. It's not the most important. The most important is the fact that the Chinese are knowing the quickest rural exodus the planet ever knew. Us in Europe, we needed almost 100 years to go from the farmer society to a city society. They do it in 2030. And we know that to build buildings is the most consuming on green gas emission. And because they are building huge cities at an incredible rhythm, you saw that in several movies, I'm sure, or documentaries, there is a sort of obligation. I said the obligation with a lot of code. They could do better, of course, to emit green gas, but that will stop quickly, because the exodus is not totally finished, but we are really at the end of the cycle. That's what the Chinese say, that in 25, some in 10 years more or less, they will stop to emit so much and they will start to reduce. They are thinking that for another reason. If you look at the global planet, no one will pay the same price for the global warming. For sure, the two countries will pay perhaps the most high price are the US and China, the two main emitters, which is a sort of moral return, if you want. But they will pay a lot. And the Chinese start to see it, and they have the double pain. They have the climate change, and they have also the pollution in the cities, all the air, all those things. That way they are trying to move. Okay, through these new evolutions, and because the US will always refuse to sign a sort of binding agreement, a legal frame binding agreement, the UN decided to change the system. And today, it's not Kyoto as it was 25 years ago, or 30 years ago. The new system today is a system named bottom-up approach. The American has named it, name and shame, which works quite well in the US tradition, meaning a country have to tell what they will do, and if they don't do it, or if what they tell is bad, shame on you. But in a lot of countries of the world, shame on you, don't care. People don't care. In the US, they care. And that's why they use this term. But the system, the system they are implementing is named the INDC. If you look at this newspaper, you will find this name, which is Intended Nationally Determined Contribution. Meaning that each country said, oh my God, I will reduce this level. Another country, this level. It's a bottom-up approach. Generally, when we say bottom-up, we like that more than top-down. But in this case, that means that there is no binding agreement possible. It's each country who said what they will do. It's a little bit the same on the Green Fund, because in Copenhagen, the US, Europe, and so on, promises to give $100 billion a year to the developed country or the poorest country to help them to have adaptation and mitigation, meaning reducing their green gas emission, but also adapting their society and their model to the new world, to a degree more. And this money is quite a lot. But also, it's mainly a bottom-up approach, and every country said what it will give. It was the Lima conference last week. You saw that in the newspaper. And the different people were happy about the Lima conference last week because it was $63 billion announced for this year. But those 63 are not grants. Most of them are private investment, meaning that if you have a company selling, solar panel in Botswana, you are part of the $63 billion economy. And of course, the people in Botswana, they are paying these solar panels. It's not a gift from the United Nations or the US or whatever. They are buying, that's it. Meaning that all those flow of investment are only investment. That's it, no more than that. Then even in the part which is given by the state, you have a little part which is a gift, but most of them are alone. Meaning that even if the interest rate is quite low, the poor country will have to reimburse. That way there is a lot of trick on this issue. What will be decided in Paris? In fact, not so many things. The Paris Agreement, if we have one, is three issues mainly. The first one, four issues. First one is what will be the rhythm of the, en français on dit la revoyure. What is the time needed to have a new big conference like that? The French want 5 years. Could be 10. 10 will be not so good. Second issue, could the country will be allowed to do worse the next time than this time? For example, a country telling, I promised to reduce of 20%. Not only I didn't do it, but next time I will only reduce for 3%. What the UN wants is to say, no, when you do a commitment, you have to do better to oblige the country to go in a good way. But it's purely a declarative. It's a declaration. Third issue, it's all the monitoring and reporting. How do you be, you are sure that the country say the truth, and how you can monitor it. And the fourth issue, which is a very, very controversial issue, is the repartition of the money between the poor. The main issue is with South Africa. If you look at South Africa, there is South African people here. No, you are. If you look at South Africa, you are a big emitter. It's really big. It's not nothing. But if you are a black African from the ENC, the government, or even a black person, you see two things, which are also true. First, one of the reasons of this high level of emission is because South Africa has a lot of mining companies. Coal, diamond, gold, and a lot of others who are polluting a lot and emitting a lot. But what people said, which is true, that those companies are not really South African. They are half or third Anglo, Britain, South African, Australian, and they are multinational capital. They are not really the property of the South African people, of course. But the second thing the people say, that for a white living in a rich area, which is emitting a lot of green gas, you have not the same responsibility than a poor black living in Soweto. And that's why they are not happy to have a law or rule who say the Burkina Faso or Malawi will get a lot of money, but South Africa none. And that's why the South African government is very hard and vetoing a little bit the system. That are the odd issue. But the scandal for people like me is that the real issue, which is the reduction of green gas emission or the contribution to the Green Fund, are not discussed in Paris. That's why, in fact, what wants to do the civil society coalition is not only to act to have the best thing possible in Paris, which is of course the case, but is to rise a real civil society movement on climate, which doesn't exist today. You have a lot of movement on environmental issues. If you look at all your countries, I don't know you, of course. We have in France a lot of struggle in gas de schiste fracking. Fracking or shell gas or shell oil, and we won. We have a lot of struggle here on GMO, and we won. There is no GMO in France, Germany, and so on. We had a lot of struggles against airports like Notre-Dame-des-Landes and other. And what I said about France is true in all our country. We have a lot of struggles. But in climate, no, because people don't know how to take it. Climate is construction process, is agriculture, is transport, is our holidays, do we want to go by plane or not? It's a lot of aspects. It's eating or not the buildings, a lot of things. And how to take it? People don't know how to do it. And what we want to do is to reverse the things, because the UNFCCC look at the green gas at the end of the pipe. They said in a country you have too much green gas emission, but they never talk about fossil energy, they never talk about renewable, and want to do the opposite. And you have, for example, you have some American here, people from the US, you're the only one. You know the movement named 350.org. 350.org. It's an environmental movement, it's strong also in India, which is really campaigning for something they name disinvest, invest. In the US uni, for example, where you have generally big fund money, or invest in financial whatever to get money to pay the uni. The campaign they do is not give one penny in coal, petrol, or gas, but put all the money in windmill or solar panel or whatever. And it's quite efficient. It works quite well. And if you do that, you can reroute, if you want, the struggle locally, because you have things to do. You can also, I don't know if some of you were there, the end of September, you were all here already, you have a big Alternativa in the Republic Place. Some of you were there? I was the only one to be there. You were there? It was nice, huh?
Yeah, it
was very nice. And it was a way, it was a market and alternative. You will get it the 5th and the 6th in Montreuil in December. It will be colder, sorry. but this idea to show that you can change the thing concretely in your city, in your neighborhood, in your university are very important. And it's what the coalition tried to do. Two last questions. It's about the right
quickly,
of nature.
So that we also ask other questions, but quickly, what are the...
It's okay. Just 4:05. We have still 1 hour. I could be brief on that. How to implement right of nature? Of course, no one has the answer. But first, does this idea reasonable or not? And I think that we have a good way to approach it. I really believe that it's a useful concept. Look, for example, at the legal system. In all the countries, we have tribunals who judge the criminals. Okay. When you have a criminal, you can imagine the worst of the worst. A criminal killing babies, eating babies. You can add horrible things to horrible things. Really the worst of the worst. Even this guy, the worst of the worst of the worst, guy or woman, whatever, when he will go to the tribunal, he has the right, and he always have a lawyer talking on behalf of him. Even the worst. Why this fact to give a lawyer to everyone will not be given to the nature? That's the beginning of the transformation of the thinking. Of course, it's not a tree. You will see, for example, we will have the coalition have a big campaign. Will be in the public service in France 2, La 3, and all the big TV and radio starting tomorrow. And if you look at the ad, you will see our campaign. And the campaign is a guy talking to a tree, saying, hey, tree, you know, you are fucked up. You are really condemned. You will die. Do something. Okay, you imagine that he cannot do something as a tree. But, and the answer at the end is no one will do it instead of us. That's the campaign we are starting. And it's a little bit this idea that why there is no one to talk on behalf of, to defend, that's the beginning of the right of nature, is to say that you have to talk on behalf. Now, how can be implemented these kind of things? But we forget that it's already the case. Look at something which is the animal right. You imagine you have a cat to stay in the horrible things. You have your cat, you take a knife, and you cut a leg. Of course, living cat without anesthetic. Really like that, you cut the leg. You know that in all the countries you can go, if not to jail, but probably to jail. Torture toward animals are not allowed anymore, and it's a good thing. I'm really in favor of that. Of course, if you have an ant or a mosquito, you kill it, and no one will put you in jail for that. But if you, it's a self-defense. But if you start to torture a dog, even a cow, not only a pet, I don't know if you saw that what happened in Alès, in this place when you are abattoir in French. I don't know how to tell it in English. Abattoir as well, abattoir. Slaughterhouse or abattoir, it was in the south of France. You have a video which is frankly not nice at all. Some of you saw it already? No? Okay, you can imagine. It's the horrible thing where the animals are killed still living, and it's quite horrible. Okay, the abattoir was closed. And there's a case, the justice will go there now. And the responsible of that will be probably condemned. I don't know at what level. But that shows that it's already the case in several issues. And I think that it's good that those laws are implemented. And behind that, there is something which is very important. It's more a society is civilized, more the society looks at nature differently. If you are in a society where the men are allowed to beat their wife, or where the couple are allowed to beat their kids, in France they are still. Not in a lot of other countries, but in France we still have the right to beat, not to torture, but to beat your kid. But in a lot of countries, Finnish. And I think it's good. And more you have a society forbidding, of course, to beat your wife or your husband, forbidding to beat your kids, and you start to see the whole things differently. You have not the right to torture your pet, and then you have not the right to torture a cow, and then. And the society are more human, meaning more respectful. And they care more about the things who value, have a value for them, including the nature. I think that we have to take it like that. It's a way to see differently the world. And it's absolutely key, because in this case, you start to see that commodification is perhaps not the best, because you can respect the nature as they are, it is. And it's a little bit this transformation of the viewpoint, which is useful, in my opinion.
Okay. The microphone. So we start with the questions, right?
Yeah. Let's. I finish. You have the turn. We have 50 minutes to talk.
Come on, okay.
I'm just adding to your point. You said that when a level of civilization is reached and everything, and the right of nature. So I agree to that point, to the right of nature. But what I wanted to add is also the love for nature. In 1970s, there was a movement in India, and that was, climate change was not like one of the main issues, 1970s, like way back. And there were just some contractors cutting the trees in a very little village. And what villagers started to do was they went and hugged the trees when people were chopping the trees. So either you chop me or you chop the tree. right? And the movement became very popular. Its name was Chipko movement. Mm-hmm. And like Chipko is like in Hindi, in English it's embrace, embrace. So the movement became very popular and they had to stop. So it is maybe also the love for nature. It's not only the right of nature. It's we live here, we are in harmony with each other. So maybe.
Okay. No, I agree. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to ask you a question about this coalition, Climate 2021. You said that you thought basically the real issues wouldn't be discussed at the COP21. Do you think we have to do this coalition to mobilize the civil society? Because, like, if we don't do this, actually, we won't do anything. But at the same time, don't you have the impression that all the theoretical progress, even all the progress which was done in the past year, and even the theoretical progress, came from countries who are actually people. Going in our sense, were at power, like in Bolivia, in Ecuador, because you said it wasn't socialism, the movement of Evo Morales is called the Movimiento al Socialismo, basically, do you think that because of what can happen in other countries on international negotiations, there's a chance for these countries to not to have only the wonderful speech by Chavez like there was in 2009, but to get further? And do you think this is complementary or that just we just have to count on them and wait?
So I'm trying to make a link between what you said about political philosophy, liberalism, and reactionaries, and what you said about the huge coalition for the climate. So it seems to me that ecology is like a hodgepodge and kind of a buzzword. And I would like to ask you to specify what are the different families in the ecological movement. Because, for instance, in your presentation, you talk about the tradition of reactionaries, that thing that is not possible and inviolable to make society better. And it's, for instance, in France, Joseph de Maistre, Louis Bonald, in the UK, Edmund Burke. And these people were from 2 centuries ago. But now in France, you have some leaders of the so-called new right who fought since 1980s that ecological issues at the core of a renewal of this reactionary thinking. And they share with, I mean, the coalition climate, they share a rejection of techno-science and a rejection of the ideology of progress. So I think it's quite dangerous to talk about ecology because you can have, you know, the worst reactionary thing, and especially with this movement called deep ecology, or even the right of modern nature. That is pretty strong too. So I would like to have your point of view on that. That is not so progressive.
So my question is a little bit related to what Lauren just said. You mentioned that you also work on big data, and basically this is related to the Internet of Things. And what they are trying to actually say is that the further we go in this in the Internet of Things, the better it is for entire society and for the green economy and for the global climate change, because the interconnection of objects will help us track everything that pollutes, and this will get better for being more green. So I'm just wondering, is this just a buzzword again for promoting something that will actually pollute more, or is it really going to help? And what's your opinion on that?
Hi. I think it's a pretty common idea that we have to I think it's a pretty common idea that we have to reduce our level of consumption in the future because the planet can't handle anymore. But I think I'm not an expert, but I get the impression that we talk about a lot about the climate change and all these problems, but I don't see it's integrated in a more in an economic discussion about how we can see how we can produce new models of economy that can handle the reduction of our levels of consumption, because right now if we reduce consumption we reduce growth and there's an implication on jobs and wages and employment. So I get the impression that I don't see this integrated on the discussion of new forms of economic models. So I was wondering if you could talk a little about if there are some new models that are being discussed, something like that. Thank you.
Here. No. Okay.
Oh, I can tell all your questions were very good. I agree that the right of nature come from the Ecuadorian and Bolivian people, because they have there a very particular cosmogony, vision of the world, which is seen by the scholar as one of the fourth possible vision of the world. And they created this concept of right of nature linked to the buen vivir you were talking about. But that is very specific to Bolivia, Ecuador. In India, you have very similar things, but with other words, other vision of the world, and true in other parts of the world. But your example was really good. I will come later on this coalition and state power and relation with civil society. I want to say two things first about the family of ecology and what you said about economy, and then a little bit about the Internet of Things. The family of ecology, you are totally right, there are a lot, of course, and one of them take back a little part of the conservatism of reactionary philosophy. Look at something which is important in France and perhaps in your countries as well, what we name the precaution principle. You know this expression, that you have to have a principle of precaution. Okay, the ecology people and all the families are in favor of that. Me too, no problem. But at the same time, it's a little bit the Pandora box I was telling about in my first presentation. The precaution principle means that you have things you cannot do because you opened the Pandora box. Some of them, we will all agree. Look, for example, at to duplicate human being. It's technically possible today. You know that Dolly was the first sheep was duplicated. If you can duplicate a sheep, you can duplicate a human being. It's more or less the same. Meaning that we could have your double. Okay. In all the human society, it's seen as inacceptable under this precaution principle. But this precaution principle, even if we probably all agree on that, I'm sure that no one here wants to have his clone, his double, and so on. No problem, I'm sure of that among you. But at the same time, it's the beginning of the reactionary philosophy, because it's again the Pandora box. And I think that we have to admit that, that what those people were telling were not purely craziness and so on. It was totally wrong when we talk about the classic historical power you have to maintain, like the king, the pater familias, the landlord. We have to be rid of that. But when you talk about some scientific experiments, there are some when we say no. And I think it's good. I have absolutely no problem. Okay. Now the deep ecology. You are touching something which is one of the family of ecology, but which is quite far from what I am believing at. Look at the US movement of ecology, because they were one of the countries where there is a sort of reaction to the overextension of industry, destruction of nature, killing the bisons and all those things. And there is a guy, perhaps you know the name, John Muir. John Muir is the guy, it was both an adventurer, geographer, whatever. He was the first to create the environmental NGOs named the Sierra Club, the name of the movement, which is one of the most important movements in the US. But he also convinced the president of the Republic of this time to create the national parks. The concept of national park was born in the US at the end of the 19th century through the impulsion of John Muir. But this John Muir had a formula which is very American, perhaps Anglo-Saxon, but I doubt even, American for sure, which is the wilderness. You know what wilderness means? Okay. You use it in India?
Wilderness, we use like something in English, yes, wilderness.
Yeah, but it's not something which is common in the Indian culture. Yeah. Now, in the US, it's very important. When you go to a national park in the US, you have parts when you are not allowed to go at all. It's a wilderness. And the first thing they did is to expel, you imagine, who? The American Indian. Because they were bastards with ruining the wilderness out, the indigenous people. It's the first thing they did, to protect the nature. And when you look at this vision, in fact, it's the same than the Cartesian vision in the other way. Meaning that humans are either the domination, the dominator of nature, or it's bad for nature. That in both ways, you have to have a separation. When in a lot of other cultures, like Bolivia, Ecuador, India, I'm sure, you have much more relationship. And what matters is you embrace the tree. And what counts for you is the relationship, and not the separation. And the deep ecology, it's an ideology of separation. Humans are bad as such. When in a lot of other theories, and I'm thinking at India, Bolivia, and so on, the things are more interconnected. You are talking of the relationship between. And to talk again about your first question is how to realize these kind of things, to improve it, to create a legal frame. You know perhaps Bruno Latour, which is one of the STS, science and technology guy. Discutable, we can talk about what he's telling and his theories. But one of his ideas, it's quite funny, but not bad, is the idea of the lawyer defending someone. He said that we need to have another parliament. Okay, we can have the normal Congress, the parliament, but we need a parliament of things, the parliament of non-human. When one deputy will talk on behalf of the tree or the forest, another one on behalf of the cow, another one on behalf of the ocean or the water or whatever you want. And when you start to think at that, you start at a relationship and not at the exclusion between nature and culture. About the consumption and economy, what you said at the end, I think that it's really one of the reasons of this master, is that the economy is done for growth. The point of the economy is the growth, that's it. And political economy, you know Karl Polanyi and people like that, they are not talking only about growth. They how to re-embed the economy in the society. And when you do that, you need new figures, new indicators, new way of thinking. But honestly, we need it in the 21st century, but it's not really done. It's not at all my field, but it's your job and David's job to help to create those kind of things. And I know that a lot of people are interested. Stiglitz and a lot of others, Nobel Prize or the last one, think that there is a real problem around that. But I really believe that for a political economy vision or perspective or a more critical economy, name it as you want, doesn't matter, it's one of the biggest challenge. Because if economy is always looking at growth, you are the world is fucked up. I give you one example which is very French but very classic. You know that we have a so-called left government and we had this summer a big agricultural crisis with farmers everywhere. You were not there, but even in September when you arrived, you saw on the TV farmers, whatever, whatever. There is several reasons of the crisis. The two main reasons is three reasons. One is because we are eating less meat. The consumption of meat is changing. We eat more vegetable and so on, which is good for our health and for the animals, and no problem. Two, the Germans didn't have at this time a minimum wage. They are changing the law, meaning that they could employ Polish, Czech, and whatever at a low price, and their production costs were under. And the third reason is the Russian embargo because of Ukrainian war. Okay, those three reasons explain why we had this crisis. Le Foll, Stéphane Le Foll, which is the French spokesperson of the government, but also the agriculture minister, is a guy who knows well agriculture. He's not purely a technocrat arriving in a field he knows nothing about. He knows. And what he knows is that the French agricultural model is dead. Because it's a mass production, producing bad product. For example, you know all the Kentucky Fried Chicken. When you go in a Kentucky Fried Chicken, the chicken is like, I don't know, mashed potatoes. It's a going like that. You all experience that because it's cheap, and whatever, I'm sure you know. But frankly, in between a Kentucky Fried Chicken experience and a real chicken, who was a chicken who was growing in a farm, in an organic way and so on, it's not at all the same thing. And what Stéphane Leffel knows is that the only way for the future of the French agriculture is the organic chicken, short circuit, and so on, because it's the demand of the consumer. And it's also sustainable because you have something which is locally produced and whatever, whatever. He knows that. But because of the crisis, the only answer he gave to the farmer is, we will make more easy for you to have a big loan at the bank to double the size of your exploitation of chicken and pork. Pigs, meaning that they will produce more and more shit. And that was the answer of a guy who knows the topic. And because economy is done like that, you need to have growth to be bigger and to, because it's the only way you are calculating, thinking, counting the world. And that have to be changed. That's why this kind of master is wise for, if you want. Internet of Things and the state power. Internet of Things. Yeah, for part it's a buzz, but it's also a reality, meaning that you have a lot of problems. The first problem, the things are generally very basic. You know what the first problem of Internet of Things is? Who will change the battery? It's stupid, because there are very useful things. The first thing we said in Internet of Things is to put, for example, little captors, little device in water field, in rivers. And when you have a flood, you can anticipate 2 days in advance and avoid to have dead people at the end because the water is a running flow. Okay, that's great. Everyone thinks that's a good idea. No one will say that it's bad. Everyone agrees. The only problem is, will we go to change the battery? Because every 2 months, you have to change the battery. Now, it looks stupid, but it's not stupid. I can tell you that in practice, it's this kind of things which is a limitation of the Internet of Things. What I believe is that, of course, there are interesting things happening, but there are a lot of buzz. The buzz because of that, very practical issues are not at all resolved, like the battery issue. It's something looks stupid, but it's very important. And also, the marketing is branding things who are so stupid. You know, the main example they give about Internet of Things is, my God, one day you can come back home and drama. There is no Coke in the fridge. What you really, really, really need is a fridge which is part of the Internet of Things and which is able to order to the supermarket to deliver you Coke before your Coke for the bottles are almost finished. That is really what you need. That is the kind of marketing discourse you have about that. But frankly, look at the real life. Are you really anxious arriving at home? My God, I'm not sure to have fridge in the to have Coke in the fridge. I stay. Not at all. You are not like that. And if you really need a Coke, you go to the supermarket and you buy your Coke and that's it. Meaning that you see what I mean? You have a lot of promises like that done by the marketing. When you look at the end, okay, that will not work. You will not pay €100 more to have a self-ordering Coke system in your fridge. That's why it's a little bit of buzz, in my opinion. But at long term, it's something important, of course. And that will change. Big data, it's extremely important as well. I will not enter on that because it will be too long. But yeah, you have new things to learn and to look after. The powers of state. Okay, in what you said, I can answer immediately to this, why there is no political party. There is two reasons. One which is extremely French and only French is that the French unionism built itself 1 century and 10 years ago in 1905 against the party. Totally different than Britain. No, but I can tell you that that's the one who veto the presence of the parties are the unions. They veto. And even if the problem we have in the coalition, the main problem is the unions. Because, for example, the unions defend nuclear because they have workers working in nuclear, when most of the environmental groups are not very happy with nuclear, as you can imagine. But we have problem with the union, but we all believe that it's very important to have the union. If we don't have organization with millions of members, it will be difficult to change the world. And that's why we want to have them, but they veto the political party. That's very French. Then there is a more deep issue. I told you that the COP is 40,000 people during 2 weeks a year. In fact, it's not only 2 weeks a year. In the middle of the year, in June, you have in Bonn, in Germany, because that's the headquarters of the UNFCCC, 2 weeks of negotiation. And very often, it was the case 1 week in September this year in Bonn, and next week I will go to Bonn because there is another week of negotiation, meaning that in 2015, the negotiators and the civil society people will have passed 6 weeks together. And that's true for the last 21 years. 6 weeks multiplied by 21 for the oldest, of course, the one who are here from the beginning. You have a level of competences and skill, also jargon and stupidities as well. It's not to say that everything is useful. You have a lot of shit as well. But you have at the same time such a level of expertise in the state negotiators level, as well as in the civil society, that when you talk with a political party, it generally doesn't understand the discussion. And that's true for the right, the left, the radical left, the ecologists, more or less all, for this specificity of the UNFCCC. But again, that's come by the fact that there is no movement on climate, meaning that the UN frame is framing the way the people are talking about, which is bad, in my opinion. Because people don't talk about fossil energy or fossil fuel or whatever. They don't talk about renewable. They talk about red plus. You are talking about that. They talk about this kind of end of the pipe issues, but not from the real problems. Now, what the relationship between government and civil society? I gave this example of the agricultural crisis in France, but it's true also in Bolivia and Ecuador. There is a sort of bad evolution today of those governments toward ecology. Bolivia, for example, Evo Morales was great 5 years ago, said now that they want to deforest 20% of the country, and there was this bloody imperialist capitalist country who refused that when they did much worse, this kind of classic rhetoric and so on, which is not a good idea. And you have a lot of movement in Bolivia who disagree with that, in Ecuador as well. And I think that what the civil society has to be able to do is to have the correlation of forces to really impose good decision. And we are far from. And when you look at what corporations are doing, look at the Volkswagen case, frankly, it's unbelievable. And you realize, looking at that, that you really need to have a civil society who is able to rise up and to hang up and to defend not only the right of nature, but our right on the climate issue, because it's a problem of the humanity.
A few additional questions? Last round, last chance.
Thanks. I wanted to ask quickly about your sort of strategic vision for this movement that's emerging. As you mentioned, it seems that there's a kind of change in tone and approach with this conference, that it's not just the usual kind of civil society attachment, that there is kind of building towards a global, kind of mass-based movement. And I think the slogan of Paris and beyond is kind of reflective of that, that it's going to be something continuous, hopefully. And in the presentation, you started to talk a little bit about some of the real difficulties with it, in terms of the fact that people struggle to imagine possible solutions or political approaches in relation to a problem that is just so kind of grand and overbearing. And it seems that so far there's none of the kind of ideologies or theories have found any means of kind of connecting that in a unifying way, of presenting the problem in such a way that we can build movements on a kind of common platform. And we've already had some of the discussion around the divisions within the ecological movement and so on. And there's also a kind of deeper problem of the fact that climate issues remain essentially removed from the immediate concerns of most people on the planet. I mean, there are people in rural areas, there are peasant communities and stuff who are having their livelihoods already affected by climate issues. But for the most people, it's things that are happening at one remove. And much as we can appreciate the problem, I think there's an issue that people are caught in this kind of what's his name? Zizek has a good word for it. I can't remember the term, but it's kind of, we can all see what's happening, but it's so far beyond us. There's nothing that we can start to do about it. So in South Africa, I was involved in some of the organizing for the COP17, where we had a lot of difficulties in relation to what came out in the end, and the fact that civil society ended up kind of It had a very non-subversive, non-confrontational tone. It ended up just being kind of handing everything on a silver platter to this conference and not doing anything to delegitimize a process that's essentially just sanctioning this kind of ongoing climate change. But the campaign that we've been working on more recently, which is something actually I think started in the UK but is now a global campaign, is the 1 million climate jobs movement. So the attempt there is obviously to connect very closely the unemployment, the economic crisis in South Africa with the issues of labor, with the ecological movement. And we've had certain successes in the way we've been working with unions, but we're obviously facing kind of major difficulties, as you already talked about, the problems that you're having in France, and you can imagine in South Africa, as you said, a highly minerals-addicted economy, despite all the kind of the best theoretical efforts that we've done around this idea of a just transition, it's very difficult to have got that kind of mass buy-in from labor that we need to really turn this into a strong campaign. So I'm wondering if you have any kind of an idea of what you think are the main kind of strategic questions and tasks for this developing movement.
Well, my question is quite similar to Niall's, actually, because with a different approach, because I wanted to ask you if you could talk a little bit more about clean energy, because for me, clean energy is one of the parts of climate change that actually has received a preventing climate change that has received a lot of attention, because that's where a lot of money is, lots of investments, lots of firms making bets. And it's actually, it's also a way that you can maybe like reduce CO2 emissions without actually having to discuss changing consumption, reducing consumption, or you can you can bypass it. And basically what I wanted to ask is, for me, we are talking a lot about civil society participation, but when we see this part of, let's say, clean energy, it's still a lot focused on, let's say, technology that's being developed by firms in developed countries. And you talked as well about common-based technology learning. And for me, we're not addressing this disconnection that there is the problem that we have between developed and developing countries. It's not being addressed, because usually if we're talking about this division between developed and developing, it goes into a discussion maybe of poverty and other stuff. It's not connected to, let's say, climate change. And what can we do, you know, to address this, you know, basically?
Hi, I'm from the United States, where about half of the population doesn't believe in climate change. I thought it was interesting because, like, the beginning of both presentations, you guys kind of presented, okay, well, climate change is obviously happening. You all know what's going on. Mm-hmm. We can just jump into the real discussion here. That would have been scandalous in my country. You can't do that. And it's funny, and we're all laughing, but that seems like a massive tactical problem for trying to address climate change. As you said, our Congress couldn't pass Kyoto. We're not going to pass whatever we do in Paris. We're having an election coming up, and if the Republicans take control, there goes any chance of climate change for at least 4 years. So I guess I wonder, for the international movement of trying to do something about climate change, how important is it to win the PR battle in the United States? What is the story there? Because that's another thing, as far as why is it? It seems like the United States is the only country where this really is a big open question, where very reasonable, well-educated people can get into huge fights about whether or not this is even a real thing. Mm-hmm. And I guess being in Europe, everyone always kind of assumes, oh, it's just a bunch of idiots in America who like don't know what's going on. But like, I've got friends with PhDs who will fight for hours and really know what they're talking about, and still don't believe either that this is caused by humans or that this is something we can actually do something about. I guess it just, in America, it seems like it's presented as a much, much more complicated problem than it is, whereas over here, it seems like it's presented as a political problem where we just have to get the will together to do something about it. So I guess I was wondering if you could just address sort of how important is that one of the largest countries in the world can't get its act together on this? And what can the rest of the world do to help that process?
Mm-hmm. Hello, I'm from Taiwan, and I agree with Jay Christopher said, because United States and Taiwan are obviously the only two countries that didn't sign the Kyoto Protocol, and that I don't believe in climate change too. In turn, that people cannot give on the economic development, so people will find another alternatives to generate like those kind of electricities. So we seek for like nuclear powers, but I believe that nuclear power is not will definitely do a lot of damage than those kind of greenhouse gas emission. So what do you think about this? Because it's like people nowadays only talk about the CO2 emission, but a lot of people seems like ignore the importance of the nuclear power that will also do huge damage to the environment. Yeah. So what do you think about this?
I will try. Thanks. Nuclear is the most simple for me. When you look at the big figure, nuclear plants represent today less than 5% of the production of energy around the world. I think it's 3%, at least less than 5. Altogether, not electricity, electricity more. But if you look at the global consumption of energy, like petrol for your car, heating system or whatever, nuclear is really less than 5. Even if you double the production of nuclear, and double the production of nuclear, meaning that, for example, you will have a lot of nuclear plants in Saudi Arabia and countries like that, who can explode like Syria in the next 5 years. And you imagine Syria war with 5, 10, 20 nuclear plants. It's crazy. It's frightening. Frankly, it's frightening, because you can have ISIS, Daesh with nuclear weapons, and all those at the same time. You imagine the problem, meaning that to imagine that nuclear could be the answer, I'm totally like you, and of course Fukushima and Chernobyl show the danger of nuclear. That's why I'm really anti-nuclear. I think it's a craziness. You are going in a world where the danger of dissemination will explode. You know why a lot of countries created nuclear plant. Because when you have a nuclear plant, you have atomic bomb. It's easy. That's it. That's why India, Pakistan, Iran wanted to have a nuclear plant. And France, I'm not blaming the others, France as well. That means that to start in a so complex and dangerous world to create nuclear plant because it's a good way for Areva or EDF to do good business, it's a craziness. I'm very sensitive on this issue like you, no problem. After the US and Taiwan, I think that in what you say, there is different level. I really believe that someone who look at the science to say that it's not the human activity who create the climate change, you have really to look at what the IPCC said and you can read it and so on. I think it could be easy, at one term, probably easy to convince the people in the US of that. Then the other issue is to see what can we do, which is another issue, because you can say, okay, it's human activity result, but too complex, we cannot handle that. That's the second level of discussion. And I think this one is more interesting, because behind that, it's a problem, it was George Bush who tell it, that there is something which is not negotiable, which is the American way of life. And of course, when you, it's what he said, it's not me. He said that about climate negotiation, that everything is discutable, but not the American way of life, not negotiable. But meaning that behind that is the fact that some society, Australia more even than the US, you have huge suburbs spread out everywhere, meaning that you need car and you have this system. But okay, but now if you want to look it in another way, in the US, same country, you had in New York the biggest demonstration September 21st last year that your country had from the 70s and the Vietnam War. That show that a part of the America is also moving. They were expecting 100,000. And in the US, for those who don't know, it's not like Spain, Italy, or France. And to put 1 million of demonstrators in the street, that never happened, never. And to have, they expected 100,000, they got, according to the police, 350,000, which means that this demonstration in New York in September, just 1 year ago, is the biggest from the anti-war demonstration in the 70s. That showed that, okay, some things are moving. And now look at the American way of life. I don't know where you live, the first time we met, but something is very interesting. In Europe, it's also why the people are reacting like that. Most of the people prefer to live inner city. If you give to the choice to a friend, do you want to live at 20 kilometers from Paris? You will have a little garden and whatever, or in the Marais. Everyone will say the Marais. Forget the garden. We can go to the park or whatever. That's as to all the French who are here. There is a universal answer to that. And it's true in Italy, in Germany, in Spain. It's not a French reaction. It's an European reaction. Look in the US now. Downtown become more fashionable, more. There is a big shift. When you look at demography, a lot of people like you, young people, well-educated now, they start to recolonize, if you want, downtown cities. I think it's this kind of thing who could help to transform a little bit the relationship you, but the American people have toward those issues, because behind that is a way of life, which is a real issue. Huh? It's not something you can joke with like that. Huh? It's a real issue. Now, about clean energy, the South, and it's something important because, for example, you look at the Toyota Prius and all those things. It's clean, but when you look at the 10 years life of this car and you look at the input, output, and the global cost, it's not so green. And we have the first problem to really assess what's the really green energy is. At the same time, it's true that technology, time to time technology are useful. Look at the solar panel. The price is really plunging, and the quality and the, it's increasing a lot. That means that behind that, the discussion is the discussion you start, is relationship between North and South. And I can tell you that in the UNFCCC negotiation, one of the key issues, and is a strong demand from the South, and totally justified, in my opinion, which is to have no patent on those technologies, to allow those people to have not for free, but a very affordable price, these kind of things. And as you know, most of the South country, the poor country are in the South when they have a lot of sun, meaning that you have also a solution to have affordable and renewable energy. But it's a very important discussion. It's one of the main controversial issues in the UNFCCC. The other one is what we name the loss and damages, is when you have in the Philippines, you have some people from the Philippines now? You remember 1 year and a half ago, there was the most damageable and horrible typhoon on the Earth, at least in the capacity to remember that and to record that, the biggest one, that was in the Philippines. Who will pay the cost of that? When people are starting to ask in the UNFCCC to have a sort of legal frame to make those people eligible to a case and to have paid their loss and damages. It's the second very conflictive issue, but interesting issue at the same time. Now, what could be this new movement you talk about from Durban and South Africa? I really believe that the key word people use here is really to root the movement. If you have no roots, the risk is to have a movement a little bit under air, going from summit to summit, one day Paris, 5 years later, I don't know where and whatever, without being a real social movement and a civil society movement. If you want to have a civil society movement, a social movement, you have to have roots. And those roots are always local. Roots is not something in the air, meaning that you have to have struggle against useless project or damaging for the CO2 and other greenhouse gas emission project. You have to have struggles on alternatives at local level, and you have a lot of things you can do. You can do commons on energy. I know that several cities in Germany, they start in France, want to use what we name in French the régie, which is a sort of municipal common, to be quick on that. They had it in water, but now they want to have it in energy. And they set up windmill, for example, or municipal windmill, to not be only market-oriented, but really part of what the community can manage. And if you do that, that's give to the people from the ground the possibility to discuss what they want. Do we want to have a light open until 2 o'clock in the night or midnight? Whatever. It's a small thing, but behind that is a more global issue. And to root those movements are absolutely key. It's really what we want to do. And I know that in your country as well, it's in the UK, you have a good movement like 1 million jobs. Is the idea that you can locally relocated jobs on these big energy transition and economy transition, because it's also an economy transition. And we have a lot of work, people we work with, like Brian Ashley, Patrick Bond, and all the folk from South Africa. We were with them in Durban, and we work with them. They will be in Paris, I'm sure you will meet them.
Thank you very much.
No, no.